There was a lot of stuff around vibrators. I had the bedroom next to my parents and heard sex. I knew my dad messed around on my mother. I've got many journals where I've got drawings that are, it's naked people chained up and having sex. It's stuff that you shouldn't be drawing at age 8, 9, and 10, but that was my environment. So that's the stuff I was exposed to. And so I remember the first time I heard it too. I was in the car, also going to school. It was a carpool situation, and it was on K-Rock. And I remember hearing it on the radio for the first time, and I was like, that's crazy. And then my mother was driving, and the car was swarmed by some friends I knew who also had heard it on the drive to school. And it must have been about, I think I was 13, and I was pretty frustrated with the way the house was run. My father was touring all the time, and sometimes eight months out of the year. So that's a long time to go without seeing the steady parental figure in the house. He never raised his voice. He was so funny. He was so smart, so talented, so playful, very improvisational. And so to miss that kind of stability and that grounding was really just not great to just be stuck with a mom who is really missing him as well, and to, as the oldest kid, to have to pick up the slack and help care for my younger siblings. Dweezil was 2 years younger, Amit was 7 years younger, Diva was 12 years younger. So when I was 13, Diva was just a baby, so she was calling me Mommy Moon. And so I had a lot of responsibility, and I was like, get back here, you take care of your family. And then when he was home, he would sleep during the day and work at night. So then there were restrictions on our own expression and having to be quiet in the house. And then the world was always revolving around him. So that's the backdrop there. And so, yeah, I said, okay, it seems to me the place you spend most of your time when you're here is in the studio. So why don't we work together? So I wrote a note and I said, it's come to my attention, something of the sort, that would be great if you would look for an opportunity where we could work together. If that's the only way I'm going to get to spend time with you, then let's work together. Mm. You can contact my people, meaning Gail, just call upstairs, and my manager, ha ha ha, will arrange it. And
oh my God.
And so I think a couple of months went by, maybe 1 or 2 months. I don't really remember, but then he woke me up on a school night. So it wasn't great timing for me, but you gotta leap. If you make the request and then somebody comes through, then I didn't know I could say, actually, can you come back when it's better for me?
What time was it? Wasn't it like super late or something?
I don't know, 2 in the morning on a school night. So I went downstairs, and he had a vocal booth in the house. And so I went to the vocal booth, and I had the headphones on, and I was listening to the bass, the track with just drums and bass, and the melody there. And then he had the chorus already on the track. And then he just said, just improvise in between the choruses. And so I had done this voice that I called this Val speak voice, or the surfer dude voice. And it was a voice I had picked up going to school in the valley. And it was a kind of just something that made him laugh. And so I would just start talking. And then after I'd get through the song once, he'd then say, okay, this time talk about how annoying it is to clean the cat box. And so then I would talk about that. And then we'd go back and forth with some improvisations. We'd use dialogue that I'd heard, or he'd say, use these words. And we made up new lingo to play around with. It just made us laugh. And I didn't think anything of it. It was just a bonding time with my dad.
And I'm shocked that it was, sorry to interrupt, but I'm shocked that it was improvised. Is there stuff that you didn't use? Are there outtakes? Is there a longer remix of, like, because, you know, I think what, it's like three verses. There's the cat box, there's the nails, there's a Mr. Bufu, there's a, actually there's a lot. There's a S&M, Leather Teddy. There's like five talking vignettes. Yeah. Is there anything you didn't use, or that's, well, in the so that's somewhere?
That I hadn't, I mean, I'm sure there's plenty of stuff that was left on the floor there while he was editing it. But it wasn't until recently that I heard that from Ahmet. He said that there's some stuff you should hear. There's some outtake stuff that didn't get used. And then Universal had contacted me to say that they had used some of the stuff I hadn't heard before for some other kind of a remix. So I know that there is stuff that exists. I haven't heard it in its entirety, but it would be fun, I think, to yeah, just to hear it just for the memory.
So of it. You said, you know, this was sort of, I don't know what school you went to, where you said you went to school in the Valley.
I went to a private school called Oakwood. It was a college preparatory school. It was where fancy families sent their kids at the time. So, but it was also a super hippie school, because you'd go to the classes and you didn't have to wear your shoes to class, and you call the teachers by their first name. And we had an apple machine in the courtyard. We can get a green or red apple for 25 cents instead of a soda pop or something. It was a Pippin or a Red Delicious instead.
Did you know girls, like, you know, Frank wanted you to make fun of girls you knew. Did you know, or kids you knew, did you know kids that, like, actually really talked like Andrea, you know?
I don't know that my father was wanting me to make fun of anybody. I think he was just trying to create, I mean, I feel like he would kind of like zero in on an archetype and a kind of, they were mini worlds you were dropped into. So they were little journeys unto themselves. And so I think that voice first made him laugh, and it delighted him. And that was an amalgamation of the different types of kids that I went to school with for the first time. I mean, I hadn't known about the Valley prior to that. We lived in Laurel Canyon. There were no sidewalks. You didn't know you had a neighbor until some parent or you were old enough to drive. Then you'd be like, where do you live? It turns out they live three doors down. But it was a kind of a I was pretty isolated up there. So, and our house was like the Winchester house, the mystery house, where you just, my mother had the house under construction 6 days a week. So there was always some something being constructed, and part Robinson Crusoe, part just this wild house that was, it was a lot of fun. People really liked coming to that house. So that's where I was most of the time. And so then when I went to school, that was my first exposure to different kinds of families that really lived differently than we did. So when I went to visit, say, a friend's house, and I saw that people ate dinner at the same time at a table upright with silverware, or they took hot tubs together, or they rode bicycles together like a family, or they let us take two bicycles and ride up the street. Maybe you were at the Thinnery at one point. Did you ever go to the Thinnery in Encino? It was a place where you could get chocolate slushy ice drinks that were, I think, not very many calories, because dieting was trending at the time. I think Scampi had just come onto the scene, and Pasta Primavera and Benihana's. These were the fancy.
Did you spend time at the Galleria? I got to ask, because that's where I went on my first date.
So the Galleria, of course, was a staple. That was, first of all, it was a, when you took the bus in the Valley, you'd stop at the Galleria, and then you'd switch buses to get to the beach. So you'd
Westwood. Yeah,
exactly. And so, I love people watching, and that's what I was trying to say. So when I would go to school with these kids, I'd go to bar and bat mitzvahs, and I'd get to see what I considered normal or stable families were like. And it was exotic to me. So if I saw people with preppy shirts or loafers with no socks. I was like, oh my God, this is so exciting. So going to the Galleria and seeing that culture on display, people, whatever, teenagers that were employed, that was already crazy to me.
I'm wondering what inspired some of the specific scenarios. I was listing them a minute ago. Some of them were a little bit adult, like, you know, the S&M, oh, hurt me. You know, you were 13 or 14 years old. Were you hearing, like, are these stories you heard around the Oakwood campus or at the Galleria, or did they just come from your imagination?
No, I think the S&M stuff, I think that's a product of growing up in a hypersexual home, and seeing from the time I was little, I always joke and say people were in the nude making candles near my playthings, and we had a family, not a portrait, there was a portrait in the family home of like kind of an orgy scene. There were Zippy the Pinhead cartoon comics laying around, and the Viper and Wii and Hustler, and there was a lot of stuff around vibrators. I had the bedroom next to my parents and heard sex. I knew my dad messed around on my mother. I've got many journals where I've got drawings that are, it's naked people chained up and having sex. It's stuff that you shouldn't be drawing at age 8, 9, and 10, but that was my environment. So that's the stuff I was exposed to. And so, I think it was, again, a combination of just when you tap into a kind of a character voice and you let that character speak. I mean, I do it now as a writer, as an adult. And so if you kind of like follow the tangent that the character you inhabit is thinking about. And so that's what that character wanted to be talking about. And, but again, I think the thing that people don't realize is that was me having private time with my father in a playful, theatrical, improvisational way. And I didn't filter anything. I didn't edit. I didn't censor. I just was trying to make my dad laugh. That was my objective. And so for me, having it then appear on an album was a kind of exposure and embarrassment and betrayal for me. I wasn't thinking about we're making a product. I was thinking I'm spending time with my father. And so I thought, oh no, these people are going to get their feelings hurt. My teacher's going to get his feelings hurt. I thought we were going to get sued. I thought a truant officer was going to come and take me away. Like it was very stressful for me. I didn't think about it in terms of, oh, I'm launching my career. I just thought, oh no, who are we going to get in trouble with? Now there was a lot of legal stuff growing up. And so it really put me into a state of anxiety. Plus I was going through puberty, so my skin wasn't great. So it's the last thing I want to do was have any focus on myself. And
so then he puts out Valley Girl, and it's his biggest hit. It's his only top 40 hit. It not only is a hit with you on solid gold, you know, epically lip syncing to it, but like it's nominated for a Grammy. And then it has this whole phenomenon. There's a movie, there's the Valley Girls guide to life, there's makeup lines, fashion lines, people talking like you.
So when you get this influx of an income, then it changes a lot. So when we had more money, then it just changed the dynamic in the house. It just got really, I think one of the craziest stories at one point was, or maybe this happened later, my mother bought a spiral staircase for like $200,000 or something, and then forgot to pick it up. Things of this nature. And then it was resold, where you're just like, you shouldn't have that kind of money to not remember to pick up your $200,000 spiral staircase. Anyway, that might've happened a little bit later, but anyway, I think it bonded my father and I in a way that my mother was resentful of, because now I'm in photographs with my father. I'm paired with him. He's excited to keep working with me. We did another thing called Bunny, 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 this weird video thing that super fans know about. I was on a few other albums. He'd asked me to do stuff. I went on Letterman with him, and we did a bunch of talk shows, and we traveled together here and there. And so I think that I got to be, and then I got some acting jobs from the exposure, and that's really where I had wanted to put my time and energy. And so then I was a working showbiz person. So he and I were the two showbiz people in the house. And so there, then it created a dynamic within the family. I was never wanting any of the fame part of it, but I admired my father. So I wanted to be a working artist like my father. So that, I think it changed. It just changed how the structure of the family, I think, operated. I mean, we live in a crazy world now. People do way worse stuff now than any of that then. But at that time, I think it wasn't up to me. I was a kid at the mercy of a creative process.
I actually just did karaoke last weekend, and I did Valley Girl. Because when I got to that verse, I was like, oh, like I hadn't really heard seen the words on a karaoke screen. I'm like, oh, this didn't age that well. No offense, because obviously at the time I thought nothing of it. But like, are there things about the song that you look back on, you're like, ah, don't feel totally comfortable.
But wait, what do you think didn't age well? What's something that didn't age well?
The Mr. Bufu verse, maybe a little bit. Just that, actually nothing else. But I was actually doing the karaoke in front of an 11-year-old, and I was like, hurt me, I am sure. And I'm like, oh, I hope she doesn't know what this means. You know, I don't think she did, but yeah.
I mean, what I think about it now is that at that time, I think the only other father-daughter combo that was out there was Debbie Boone and Debbie and Pat, and brother and sisters were the Osmonds and the Cassidys, and I'm trying to think of
Jacksons, I guess. What are your memories of that Solid Gold performance? Because that, if you look on YouTube and you look up Valley Girl, that's actually like because I guess there was no official music video ever made for it. That is the first.
Videos were just getting started. My father was not in that video mindset. And so that particular performance was teen magazines in my hand with all the lyrics in large font, so I could just like flip open the magazine, glance down, try to say some of the lyrics into the camera that's pointed at me, and then move to another box where some dancers are chewing gum and doing their moves, and then pick up another teen magazine and hope that I can remember something. It was just new to me, blocking and wearing high heel shoes for the first time. I got to get some special white pumps. I think my favorite other appearance was getting to do Merv Griffin. He wasn't there that night that I did that show, but Christopher Atkins from Blue Lagoon was on, and I mean, come on, that was exciting to be on the same show with Christopher Atkins. But I have a little tiny tea company, and I made my tea is called this batch is totally Assam tea. So
did you go to the Grammys with Frank? Because I looked, and as I mentioned, it was nominated for Best Rock Performance by a Duo or Group. Survivor, Eye of the Tiger, While a Good Song. Mm-hmm. You were up, that's what won. You were also up against Asia, the Jay Giles Band, and Kenny Loggins featuring Steve Perry. And then there's you and Frank Zappa, Moon and Frank Zappa doing Valley Girl.
I went, he did not go. I got to meet the Go-Go's. That was exciting. And then I'm trying to think. Yeah, then we did the American Music Awards and some other. My mother made my dress for the American Music Awards, and for the Grammys, or maybe it was the other way around, that I wore pink and brown. So I had a lot of ruffles, extreme ruffles. I looked like a weird chocolate cupcake. And some of my favorite current Vals, the daughter on Schitt's Creek. I mean, that's probably my favorite iteration of that mindset. Hysterical. I can't think of that actress's name, but she's a goddamn genius. You hear it and
the Californians on Saturday Night Live.
Right, right.
So, Clueless, the movie, definitely. Definitely. And Heather's probably
something. There's something about, like, even when I do the voice or the think about that character, my posture changes because there's something about it that is kind of cocky appreciation for their own interests. and it's a funny, again, when I first went to bar and bat mitzvahs and I saw this one girl who really was just the epitome of this kind of an idea, I just was so enchanted with her lyrical ability to move from one friend group to another friend group. She had, there seemed to be no boundaries between where she could place herself. And so if I think about it like an archetype, then I'm thinking about somebody who is ultimately free, and that it's a lightness about a freedom of freedom from heaviness. It's just, so I think there'll always be some kind of appeal if there's some part of you that longs to not carry the weight of the world on your shoulders. So if we really examine a whole psyche, then we all have these kind of parts inside of us. And so I think that's one that's, I think, always needed, especially during difficult times.
When we were talking about, you know, how you improv this, like you were talking about how you were sort of making up, like, I didn't know a lot of people who said things like grody to the max or gag me with a spoon. Did you make up those things, or did you hear like this girl you were talking about say stuff like that?
Grody to the max, I probably overheard. Gag me with a spoon, no. We made that up. I'm trying to think. I mean, again, I'd love to go back and listen to all the things that were said, because we were just having a laugh about what if those were popular things to say. So in some ways it's science fiction.
I mean, gag me with a spoon became something people said, didn't grody, bitchin', all of those things.
Bag your face. I think bag your face was partially a nod to the unknown comic at the time who was
Gong Show.
Yeah. Who was making the talk show circuits. It was a man who literally did comedy with a brown paper bag over his head. And so I think that was my dad's offering of bag your face, because we'd laughed about that guy on the Gong Show.
Amazing. So
I was enchanted by the lyrical nature of this particular type of girl who, I mean, I would have loved to have their nervous systems to just feel that I could just shop and not worry about the stresses of being, say, the eldest child, also helping to raise younger siblings. So for me to be in that fantasy moment of what it would be like to just have that kind of confidence and freedom, it was just something, again, my goal is to make my dad laugh. I'm working on a memoir at the moment, and I have one book that's out already, a few anthologies I'm parts of, but this will be my nonfiction journey. But it's funny, because writing is, even if you're writing fiction, you are in it. So it's, I think, honestly, in some ways, fiction is weirder than nonfiction, because it's the stuff that you're thinking about. Whereas if you're telling your own story, then you're telling how you've reframed it. But again, it's all storytelling, I think, is how we can make sense of our world and our lives, and we can always change a story. So if you're driving and you hit two red lights, is it a story of getting stuck, or is it a story of what happens while you're stopped at the light? Or if you hit green lights, you know, it could be the same day. What are you putting your attention on? The green lights, the red lights, a combination, and then what are you doing with that information? It's just a fun way to think about things.
I like buy the neatest mini skirts and stuff. It's like so bitchin', because like everybody's like super, super nice. It's like so bitchin'. Like,
there she goes. She just wants some bitchin' clothes. Tosses her hair and flips her hair.
I go, oh, right. Could you, like, just picture me in, a leather teddy? Yeah, right. Hurt me. I'm sure, no way. He was, freaking me out. He called me a beastie. That's just, he's totally blitzed. He goes, bag your face, I'm sure. Brody. It was really embarrassing. She's oh my god, bag those toenails. I'm sure. She goes, I don't know if I can handle this, you know? I was really embarrassed. That's gonna be really a total bummer. I'm freaking out, I'm sure. Those things that stick in your mouth are so gross. You get saliva all over them. But I don't know, it's gonna be cool, you know? I'll buy some see my smile. It'll be really cool. Except my teeth are too small. But no biggie, so awesome. It's tubular, you know? Well, I'm not really ugly or anything. It's just I don't know. You know me, I'm into the the clean stuff, Pac-Man and I don't know. My mother makes me do the dishes. It's so gross. All this stuff sticks to the plate. And it's somebody else's food, you know? It's grody to the max. I'm sure. It's really nauseating. Bark out, gag me with the spoon. Gross. I am sure. Totally.